are your ways, great are your works.
Hallelujah. 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 We had such a great time this afternoon eating and visiting with Brother Sister Groves and Brother Joash. We are so glad and thankful that they have been blessed to become our guests, and we've been blessed to having them here tonight. Hallelujah. Let's give them a good, grateful welcome. Brother Jimmy, Brother Sister, Brother Rose, Sister Rose, Brother Joyce, and the Lord. Hallelujah. In Jesus' name. Oh, hallelujah. 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 Let's give the hand clap to the Lord Jesus Christ. We're just singing a song that says, I'm a friend of God. I often find myself, God bless you, may be seated. Praise God. I don't want to keep you folks standing too long. Praise God. I find myself oftentimes listening to the words of the song we sing. Praise God. Not because I don't know the song, but I in reading the scripture, I've come to realize that in the early days of this church, early church, they would edify one another in their songs. They would teach in the songs that they sung. They didn't just sing songs because it sounded nice. Praise God. They sang songs and they taught, even as we do our children. How many know this song? A, B, C, D. Can somebody help me with that? E, F, G, H, I, J, K, L, M, N, O, P, Q. I know this is not very spiritual, but hopefully. Oh, yes. Hallelujah. Now. A, B, C. Sing with me. Give yourselves a hand. Well, I don't know about you, but I'm thankful for that song. It saved me many times when I couldn't remember my ABCs. Praise God. Hallelujah. But you know what? That's how we teach children many times. And so God is the one who designed us this way. And so when we sing songs, we are actually singing things that should edify us. Praise God. Now let me tell you this. There are songs only the people of God can sing in truth. Praise God. If you are singing, I'm a friend of God, and you're not living in a manner that's pleasing to God, you're not singing the truth. I'm not singing the truth if I'm singing, I'm a friend of God, and then go right out and grieve God by my lifestyle or the things I do or say or think. Praise God. Have you ever thought about these things? The book of Revelation tells us that there are some people that they said they sing a song no one else can sing. And one day I was reading that pastor and the Lord quickened that to me and said, that's talking about you. You can sing a song. He's talking about the church. We can sing songs nobody else can sing. When I sing, I'm baptized in Jesus' name, only somebody who understands what it is. When I sing, God filled me with the Holy Ghost, I spoke in tongues when the Holy Ghost came. Not everybody can sing that song, only somebody who has experienced this. When we sing about our revelation of who Jesus really is, that he's not the second person in any kind of Trinity. He is the mighty God. In him dwelleth all the fullness of the Godhead bodily, and we are complete in him. We are singing a song not many other people can sing. We are privileged. Praise God. Hallelujah. Amen. Praise God. So we edify one another in everything we do. No wonder the Bible says, whatever you do in word or in deed, do all in the name of the Lord Jesus. I said to somebody the other day, I've quoted that scripture many times to tell people that baptism must be done in Jesus' name because it's word and deed. But the Lord quickened that recently to me and said, Patrick, if you understand what that's saying anything you do, you must be able to do it in the name of the Lord. That the Lord showed me, that means there are some things you can't do because you could not do that in the name of the Lord. If it's contrary to the will of God, you can't do it in Jesus' name. So the Bible says whatever, so the Lord said that's just a safeguard for you. If you're going to do something, make sure you can do it in the name of the Lord. If somebody hurt you and you said, I'm going to tell this person off in the name, you can't do that. Praise God. I'm going to give this person a piece of my mind in
Jesus.
No, I can't do that. Praise God. It's a safeguard for us. Mm-hmm. Amen?
Amen.
We want to be able to do everything we do in the name of the Lord. Because we know it's pleasing to Him. Mm-hmm. Amen?
Yes.
Isn't our God so good to us, His children? I want to thank your pastor. We have just so enjoyed being with these precious folks, Brother and Sister Talbot and their family. We were just out having a meal a while ago. They fed us so well. Right now, I think my family and I are struggling to stay awake in the service. But pray for us. We'll make it, I believe. Amen. Hallelujah. In Jesus' name. Amen. But I want to thank you so much, Pastor. Thank you for having us, Sister Talbot. Thank you so much for having us. We have a brief presentation here. I was telling Pastor, I want to be mindful of this. We're getting acclimatized. You have to bear with us. We were in Africa, just came back in December after being in Africa for 4 years. In Africa, things are a little bit different than North America, as you would imagine. Praise God, for example. I was talking to Pastor about what time you folks normally would get out this evening. And he gave me an idea, praise God. And then I mentioned to him that if he ever comes to Africa and he's asked to speak, just be prepared. They will inform him that he will be given at least 2.5 hours to speak. And we will try not to take that time tonight, but just to you know, please pray for us, because coming from that and then, you know, and then going back into that. I remember the first time I was asked to speak and I looked at my name on the schedule and it said 2.5 hours. I went to the gentleman in charge, the brother in charge, and said, I think you made a mistake here. It says 2.5 hours. He said, Brother Cruz, do you need more time? I said, no. It's okay. Then I realized it was a losing battle, sir. They just don't get it. Praise God. In Africa, time moves much slower than here. Praise God. That's why when if they say to you, church starts at 10 o'clock, if you turn up at 10 o'clock, that's fine. You'll have a lot of time to pray and seek God. Amen. Praise God. But they'll get there. Amen. Praise God. Hallelujah. It's just Africa. Our bishop told me one time, he said, Brother Groves, I went to conduct a wedding. He said, I was told the wedding would start at 10 o'clock in the morning. I reached there at 9 o'clock. He traveled many miles to go to this place to perform this wedding. He said, Brother Groves, the wedding did not start until 5 o'clock in the evening. Praise God. Amen. God bless you. Welcome to Africa. No, we're not. Let's take a little trip here. You will see the country of Kenya and Sudan. There are contrasting situations, and I ask you just to please pray for us in particular with Sudan. Sudan is a brand new work. That's the country of our calling. We've been in Kenya working also for the last 4 years, but by the grace of God, we've been able to establish the church in the country of Sudan, which to us is a great, great miracle that the Lord has helped us to register the church there. And we ask you to please pray for us. It's a brand new work. It's an infant work. And we are just believing for God to do some mighty things in that country, which has seen so much war and bloodshed. Over 2.5 million people have been killed over the last 30 years of civil war in that country. And so wherever you go in Sudan, especially south, there are the remnants of the war everywhere. There are graves everywhere. Praise God. Literally, people have watered that land with their blood. But we are believing God that the Lord has now opened the door for us to go in. Praise God. Not to bury people, praise God, through war, but to bury them in Jesus' name.
Praise God. Yes.
By baptizing them in the name of the Lord Jesus. And we're believing God to help us to plant churches all over this nation. How many people will believe with us that God will help us to be able to do this? God bless you. Let's take a trip over to East Africa. God bless you.
In 2004, the Groves family were appointed missionaries to the countries of Kenya and Sudan, and in 2006 they began deputation. It was in January of 2009 that the Groves family arrived in Nairobi, Kenya. The population of Kenya, a country situated in East Africa, is over 43 million. Nairobi, the capital city, with a population of over 3 million, is now considered a major hub of East Africa. Kenya is also known worldwide for its abundant wildlife, year-round mild tropical climate, and the beautiful Great Rift Valley. The United Pentecostal Church of Kenya was established in 1972, and there are now over 400 churches with over 400 pastors and licensed ministers and over 100,000 constituents. During the last 4 years, the Groves have been primarily involved in overseeing and teaching in the Bible school, training pastors and leaders, establishing new preaching points to churches, and conducting national crusades. We give thanks for the support and prayers of all our precious partners, which has enabled us to accomplish many things. Over the last 4 years, we traveled all across the country of Kenya, as well as making several trips into South Sudan. During this time, we have personally seen literally hundreds of souls filled with the Holy Ghost, baptized in Jesus' name, and healed by the power of God, including several pastors and leaders from other religious groups.
You're amazing, God. You're amazing, God. You can bear the weight of every heavy heart. You can heal the pain. You can clean the stains. You can turn our tears into songs of praise. You're
one of the more recent highlights of our work in Kenya was establishing a vibrant youth outreach ministry. In 2011, after recognizing a need for more youth evangelism and involvement, the Groves Children started a youth ministry known as Faith and Love, or FNL, Youth Outreach Ministries. The vision of FNL was to promote youth ministry and to encourage young people in the church to get more involved in the work of God. This has been a tremendous success, resulting in a number of young people being baptized in Jesus' name, filled with the Holy Ghost, and becoming more active in their churches and communities. Crossing over the northern border of Kenya, you would find yourself in what used to be known as Sudan, Land of the Blacks, or ancient Kush. It is the largest country in Africa. Due to the war, missionaries were not permitted to enter the country. However, in 2005, a year after the girls were appointed, it was announced that a peace treaty had been signed, through which God opened the door into the country. On July 9, 2011, the Republic of South Sudan gained independence and a new country was born. The country's population is over 8 million and growing rapidly as many refugees return home. The capital city is called Juba. The country is rapidly being rebuilt now that the war has ended. With South Sudan's vast oil reserves, it is poised to become one of Africa's most vibrant economies. By God's grace, after several trips to the country, about a month later, on August 18, 2011, the United Pentecostal Church of South Sudan was registered in the newest country in the world. We currently have 3 churches, several pastors and evangelists, and just over 200 constituents in the infant UPC of South Sudan. Recently, we held our very first general conference of the UPC of South Sudan, though some believers were not able to make the long journey to the capital city, Juba. It was a dream come to pass as we all met in the church to sing and dance unto the Lord, teaching the word and calling upon the name of the Lord in prayer. Given the UPC of South Sudan is an infant church, there is a real urgency in us getting back to the field to help nurture this young church. There is also a great need to establish a Bible school to train pastors and workers in order to effectively evangelize and plant new churches throughout the country. This presents a great opportunity for all who desire to invest in the kingdom of God in East Africa. You can do so in 2 simple ways. Number 1, becoming a partner in missions, or PIM. You can become a PIM for as little as $12.50 per week, or $50 per month. Our goal is to have 4 new monthly partners. Number 2, becoming a project partner by making a one-time pledge to our project fund. If you currently partner with us, it would help us greatly if you would consider raising your support by even $10 per month. Will you consider investing some of your treasure in heaven for the people of South Sudan and Kenya? Thank you for the opportunity of sharing with you as we lay up our treasures in heaven. God bless you in Jesus' name.
I'm going to ask my son and my wife just to greet the church. Praise God. I want you to at least hear their voices. Praise God. Amen. Praise the Lord, everyone.
Praise the Lord.
Praise the Lord, everyone.
Praise the Lord.
I'm just so glad to be in the house of the Lord today, and I'm just so thankful that you all and your pastor has allowed us to be here tonight, and I'm just so happy. Every time I come into church, I just feel so good because I know there's nothing better than God. There's nothing out there that can compare to my God. And
I'm just so thankful and so just blessed just to be here, to feel His presence, to be able to hear His word and actually hear from, can you believe that? A God so great and so powerful talks to us, such tiny, just like ants. We're just like ants compared to Him. But He cares so much for us that He talks to us and He cares for every, He knows every single hair on my head.
Yes.
Can you believe that? He knows me that well. I'm just so thankful that I have a God that loves and cares for me so much. And I'm so thankful to be here tonight. God bless you all in Jesus' name.
Good morning, everyone.
Yes.
Isn't God good?
Yes.
Songwriter said He's given us so many blessings, undeserving. That's what we are. And I'm thanking God tonight for what He's doing in the church in general. You know, first of all, I want to thank Pastor and Sister Talbot and your family and this wonderful church for having us tonight, coming and fellowshipping with you. Folks, we had a wonderful meal and I almost fell asleep, but God is good. You know, in Kenya, we went to, we went to this prison. We thought it was just a home, but it was, it's a prison actually for like 8 years to 16 years old in that prison. And they are there for different things, prostitution, drugs, but it's adults that use them. And so we went there to feed them one New Year's Day, and we had a service first. It was maybe about 200 or so kids there, and we fed them, but before that we had service with them, and 35 of those children received the Holy Ghost. You know? Here. God is out there in the prison. He's everywhere. Praise God. And if, when we went and I said to the children, God is good? They said, all the time. And I said, all the time? And they said, God is good. And that's His nature. Wow. That's what they said. That's His nature. And we serve a God that He's good, and that is really His nature. He's a good God. And tonight, we are happy to be here to worship with you. We've been in Kenya for 4 years, but you know what? We're seeing God working in every direction, in every areas. We may be in that area of the field, but this is also a field, because this is one huge field we are in, and we are working together. We are one people. We're one in Christ. We are baptized. I'm a part of the church.
Yes.
I'm glad to say I'm a bride of Christ.
Yes.
And I love that. I love my husband, but I love Jesus more. Praise God! He's my husband. And I love Him. God bless you. Thank you for having us in Jesus' name. Praise God.
Oh, hallelujah.
Praise the Lord. Amen. Hallelujah. Amen. I was, when we were sharing a while ago, I was just telling Pastor, when we deputize, one of the blessings, there are many challenges with deputation, but one of the blessings of deputation is you get to see a wider picture of what God is doing in His church. As my wife said a while ago, there is only one church. Praise God. We're spread out all over this planet. Praise God. And it's amazing, though, to see how you can just see that there's only one church, and this one God is dealing with these precious people. And I was just sharing with Pastor Ho that when you see that wide perspective and you're not just in one location, you begin to realize that we're not alone in this. Praise God. God has this great, wonderful church. And let me tell you, saints of God, living for God, and I believe in the kingdom of God. Praise God. So one preacher put it this way. He said, it's like a train that runs on two tracks. Praise God. And one track is you'll see the glory of God. You'll experience great things in the presence of the Lord, and you will see the glory of God. But he said, the other track, which is just as necessary, is you will experience the sufferings of Jesus Christ. Praise God. And I don't understand it, but that's just God's way. How many know that We rejoice over the upper room and the experience. We've become a part, we've become even associated with it. I came and I saw the sign, the Pentecostals, praise God, of Creve Coeur. Praise God. We are the Pentecostals.
Yes. That's right.
But again, we're not just called by that name. We relate to that name because of our experience.
Right.
Amen?
Right.
On the day of Pentecost. And we rejoice over that. But how many understand that there would never have been a Pentecost if there was not a Calvary?
Right.
Praise God. But we also have learned to rejoice in the sufferings of Jesus Christ.
That's right.
Because we know if Jesus did not suffer and die, we would not be saved. We would never be able to receive the Holy Ghost, that glorious experience. We would never make it to heaven. So we have to embrace both. Praise God. Amen. Praise God. Hallelujah. It's very easy to embrace the glory of God. But if you are a child of God today, you have to decide, I'm going to have to be willing to suffer with Him, to reign with Him. Praise God. I want to turn your attention to the word of the Lord. Today, praise God, hallelujah, amen. I'm somewhat in two minds here. I've been asking the Lord to direct us. We don't just go into a service and kind of just go through a routine. Because we know we're still in the church and we are in the field, because the world is the field.
Right.
We may not be in South Sudan, but we're still in the field. We're just another part of the field. Amen. We try to be sensitive and ask the Lord to direct us. I want to go to the book of Matthew chapter 18, praise God, verse 11. I want to talk to us, I want to encourage someone today. I want to encourage us as the people of God in what I believe God has called us to. Matthew chapter 18, I want to read verse 11. If you find it, just hold that. I'm going to turn to another portion of scripture and refer to that, but I just want to talk to us just for a little while on this subject. Praise God. Hallelujah. Amen. Matthew chapter 18, verse 11, if you could read that together. For the Son of Man is come to save that which was lost. Everybody say lost.
Lost.
Let me see the hands of those who have ever lost anything. Hallelujah. Thank God we have some company here. Praise God. Hallelujah. I thought for a moment there I might be a bit alone, but everybody here has experienced losing something. Some things we would not even consider to be too important, but some things, and it's strange, losing something, even when it's not quite that important to somebody else, sometimes it really gives you concern. How many have ever lost your keys? I think we're in the same company here. God bless you, you may be seated. I've lost my keys on several occasions, but I remember one particular occasion I lost my keys. And Pastor, I'm not too pleasant to be around when I'm really concerned about something, when I'm really worried or concerned. I get so agitated that I begin to make other people around me start to feel uncomfortable just because I'm not happy. Praise God. And I remember losing my keys once, and I had the whole household looking for these keys. Everybody was searching the house trying to find my keys, because Dad's keys is lost and we need to find it because he's losing it. Praise God. Not his keys, that is, he's losing something else. Praise God. Amen. But all the children were much younger at the time, and they were up and down, and my wife, of course, because she's the one I turned to mainly, because she knows, how many know that women always know where everything is? I keep saying that it's because they keep hiding everything, but no, it does not. Amen. Hallelujah. I leave my towel, in a very obvious place. Amen. And then my wife comes and moves it. And I'm asking, where is my towel? And finally she tells me, well, I put it where it's supposed to be. Praise God. Amen. Hallelujah. Amen. I think we're outnumbered here, so I better be careful. Hallelujah. If a war starts, sir, we have no chance. Praise God. Hallelujah. Praise God. Anyway, back to my keys. And I remember nobody, my wife in particular, who I thought, you know, if anybody could find my keys, she would be able to find my keys. But she searched, and I got really concerned when she said, "Patrick, I can't find your keys anywhere. I've searched everywhere." And I remember going down to the basement. That time we were living in, still living in Toronto, Canada. And I remember going to the basement, and I was just so concerned. And when I was in the basement, it was like, finally, I was able to compose myself to the point where the Lord was able to kind of quicken something to me. And I realized I'd been searching down the whole house, gotten everybody all, you know, really agitated and trying to find his keys, but I had never even asked the Lord where the keys are. Now, if, let me tell you a secret. If you're married and your wife can't find it, the Lord can find it for you.
Amen.
Praise God. Hallelujah. And so I said, first of all, I repented. I said, "Lord, please forgive me. But I really haven't even prayed about this." And I said, "Lord, could you please show me where these keys are?" Because I was contemplating, what am I going to do with all, to be able to replace all these keys and, you know, get copies and whatever. And I remember I stood there for just a moment. And within that short moment, I turned. So I went up to my bedroom, which was on the second floor of the place we were living. And I went straight to my closet. I opened my closet. I held one of my jackets, which my wife had already been through all of my pockets searching. Didn't find anything. But I held this jacket and I just shook it. And when I shook it, I heard something jingle. Like that. And I felt the jacket and I felt the pockets. There was nothing in the pockets. And then when I shook it again, I heard the sound of metal, and I held the lining of the jacket, and there were the keys. They had fallen through the pocket. There was a hole in my pocket, praise God. Amen. That's a message right there. But how many have a hole in your gun? Praise God. You can't find money when you need it, praise God. But it was in the lining of my jacket. And that's why my wife had gone into the pockets, but she never thought of going beyond the pocket, because you don't put anything anywhere in the lining of your clothes. So there were the keys. And I remember I stood back and I said, how simple that was. I didn't hear an audible voice. I couldn't tell you distinctly how God spoke to me. But somehow God communicated with me to direct me right to where these keys were.
Amen.
Because God knows where everything is, and especially that which is lost.
Right.
This particular scripture that we just read tells us that this God who created the heavens and the earth, he left, so to speak, his throne. God was manifest in the flesh, the Bible tells us. God came here robed in a body of flesh, and he came here for one purpose, to save that which was lost. Praise God. Hallelujah. What I'm talking to us today about is the fact that God is concerned about the lost.
That's right.
Whatever is lost, God is concerned about it. Just like how you and I get concerned. Praise God. I saw two little ones here. Where is one? Is here. Beautiful little girls. Praise God. Amen. And I'm assuming this is mom. Praise God. Let me show you something here. Praise God. I won't put you on the spot. I won't ask you which one of them you love most. Praise God. Hallelujah. Even though parents always have these little things. You know, even the Bible tells you Jacob loved it was Isaac who loved Esau because of the food he gave him, and his mom loved Jacob because he was mama's boy. Praise God. But let me tell you this, and I just suppose, like any mom, you love your kids. Praise God. But let me tell you something. If one of these kids goes missing, which one do you think your mind will be focused on? The one that you have with you, and that is safe and sound, or the other one that is missing? There is no question. My mind automatically, this is just how we are, is going to be focused. It's almost as if, I would almost seem as if I've forgotten the other one. It's not that I love that one any less, but the fact is I am concerned about the one that is lost. Praise God. Now that's a mother's love. Praise God. We're talking about a love that goes far beyond a mother's love. We're talking about the love of God. Hallelujah. Let me tell you, church, God wants us to understand how much He's concerned about that which is lost.
That's right.
Praise God. And God, if we are the body of Christ, we have the mind of Christ, we therefore ought to be concerned about that which is lost. Praise God. That's why this church is here. Praise God.
Right.
Do you realize that if it weren't for the lost, God would possibly have taken all of you home by now? Praise God. Some of us are even wondering, why are we here still? Amen. I should have been gone long. I don't know about you, but several times, God had perfect opportunity to just take me out of the way. Praise God. One-way trip home. But God somehow left me here. But you know what? I suspect it has to do with not me, but it has to do with somebody else that is lost. Praise God. God is concerned about the lost. Let me tell you some stories that Jesus told. I'm not going to read it because it take too long. But I refer to you. When you get a chance, please. And I'm sure many of you have read it before, but read it again. The Word of God is so rich. Luke chapter 15 is where he talked about this. He talked about several things that were lost. The first thing he talked about was the lost sheep. He said, and of course people were, he was talking about these things in response to people's question. You see, when Jesus was here in the flesh, God came in flesh. You know what God did not do? God did not stick around with good religious people. Praise God.
Right.
Hallelujah. In fact, this is how he put it. That one translation I was reading, Jesus said, he said, I did not come to save the righteous. And one translation put it that I did not come to save good people. And I looked at it and I said, God, that sounds strange. But then the Lord started quickening to me the other scriptures that would confirm that, because the Bible says there is none good, not even one. So I'm glad he didn't come for good people, because I wouldn't be in that number. Praise God. You and I wouldn't make it. Amen. Because the Bible says there is not even one good. So thank God he didn't come for good people. But when Jesus was here in the flesh, you know what type of people he would hang around with? He would hang around with people who people knew these were no good people. Praise God. He would not hang around with the quote unquote respectable people of your and I town, our community. And so people had problems, the religious folks had problems with that. They said, why are you hanging out with these people? Do you know who these people are? Of course he knew. And Jesus would say to them, I didn't come to call the righteous. Folks, let me tell you this, I didn't come to have my church filled with a bunch of righteous, self-righteous people.
That's right.
I came to call sinners.
Yes.
Messed up people to repentance. Why? Because I came for people who are lost.
Oh, hallelujah.
Praise God. If you feel you're okay, I can't help you. But if you know you're lost, or somehow you are lost, knowing or not, I can help you. Because I came for you. Praise God. Jesus, first story he told was about the lost sheep. He said it's like a man that had 900 sheep. One got lost. Guess what he did? He left 99 good sheep and went after one lost sheep. And the only way, again, I can comprehend that, a farmer would be able to comprehend that fully, But the only way I can comprehend is like using this precious mother here and her children. Because I'm telling you, if her baby was lost, whether it's the older or the younger one, her mind would be focused on the one that is lost. And that's what Jesus is telling us. That's how God is. He said that that man who lost his sheep would go after, he would leave the 99 that were safe and sound, and he would go after the one and search until he found him.
That's right.
Hallelujah. Amen. Now the sheep that is lost could have been lost simply because he wasn't paying attention. You know, sheep need a shepherd. Praise God. And where we're from, again, when we live in Africa, we see many of these farmers or sheep herders. They have these particular people in particular named Maasai, and they love just herding cattle and animals. And you will see them walking along with the sheep, and it's amazing how, you know, I every time I see them with the sheep and how the sheep just follow them. Praise God. They're walking right by the highway, and all these sheep just walking along with them, none going out into the road, and I'm just amazed, you know. Praise God. But Jesus said that shepherd will leave that 99 sheep, go after one, and will not stop until he finds it. Church, do we have that kind of burden and that desire to see the lost? That we will leave the crowd. That is okay. We will leave, you know, some good things happening. When I'm telling you, if you have 99 sheep, you're doing well. Praise God. Hallelujah. Many people will tell you this, especially if you have 99 saints that are living for God, and God is moving and everybody's healthy and doing well, you have good things going on. But Jesus is saying, the shepherd that has his heart will leave that 99 and go out there to find the one that's missing. The one that lost their way. Praise God. That speaks to me of someone in the church that somehow just got their eyes off what they should be focusing on and got lost. Hallelujah. No fault of the shepherd. You can't even blame the sheep. That's just a sheep. Praise God. Just went astray, but nevertheless found itself lost. What does God expect us to do? He does not expect us to stay with the 99 faithful sheep, quote unquote, 99 okay sheep, and say, well, let's just wait until he or she finds out that they're lost and get back home. No, that sheep can't do that. It needs someone to come looking for them. Praise God. That's who sheep are. You need to go find him. Find her. Because you know what? She's not out there, or he's not out there because they want to be. They just got lost. Mm-hmm. Praise God. God says, I would go look for that sheep. Mm-hmm. I would leave all the good stuff and I'd go find that one sheep that's in trouble. Church, do we want to be that type of church? Hallelujah. Not just being happy with what God is doing here, but going out there, going find that one more servant. Hallelujah. Then he talked about the lost coin. The lost coin, he said a woman had 10 coins and lost one in the house. Imagine that. Now, this is the scenario where this seems like the fault is with the mother, the woman. And I'm using for purposes that we're talking about here, I'm relating that mother to the church. And sometimes, church, if we are honest, sometimes we make some mistakes. Praise God. Mm-hmm. And we lose some as a result of us not doing something or not being careful about something, and we end up losing someone. But what does, and the Bible says that one was lost in the house. You can be in the house and still be lost. Praise God. But what does that woman do? She doesn't just forget about it and say, well, it's only one and I still have the majority. No, She sweeps the house. She lights a candle and she sweeps the house looking for one until she finds.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah. That tells me that church will not be satisfied just to know we have some numbers. We want to know that everybody in the church is genuinely in the church. Hallelujah. Full of the Holy Ghost. Living for God. Ready to meet Jesus anytime he comes. Because his heart is toward the lost. Hallelujah. And I'm telling you, you can tell sometimes when people are in the house but they're lost. Because you can almost see that there's no connection. But the Bible says the concerned church will go after that one until they find that one. Hallelujah. They will rejoice. That's what happens sometimes in some services when somebody prays through and touches God. And you realize God had restored this person. Hallelujah. And Jesus talks about a lost boy. Now in this case, this younger boy, two sons, younger one says, give me everything that I have come to me. I'm going out there and I'm going to live the way I want to live. I'm going to do what I want to do. This is presumptuously lost. Praise God. He decides I'm going to go deep, do it my way. And unfortunately, he followed his way. It was not God's way. And it was the wrong way. And eventually, guess what? He got lost. Lost in this world. And that happens sometimes, saints of God. Notice one thing. The father did not go after this boy. Because, you see, he knew exactly what he was doing. That boy presumptuously decided, I'm going to go. You can't, what would you go out there and tell him? Come back home. This is where you belong. He knew what he was leaving. Yes. No. That person who knowingly does what they want to do and decide they're going to leave the house of God, they're going to leave the things of God, they're going to walk away from the presence of God. The only thing you and I can do is pray that somehow God will deal with them and bring them to their senses. And that happened to this little boy. Because one day while he was in the pig pen, he came to himself when he was at his lowest point, and he said, look what I'm doing, look who I'm living. And in my father's house, the servants are doing better than I am.
That's right.
Praise God. He said, this doesn't make any sense. Why am I out here? He said, you know what I'll do? I'll go back home. I'll tell my dad, Dad, forgive me. I've sinned against you, against heaven. But I want to be here. And he said, Dad, I don't even want to be called a son anymore. I just want to be a servant.
Right.
Hallelujah. And that's what God is looking for. People who just want to serve in the house of God. Who don't feel any special privilege.
Yes.
You know, there's sometimes where we can get to a point where if we're not, we don't have a certain position or we're not doing certain things, we feel like we need to be somewhere else. But really, Jesus said the greatest thing you can be in the kingdom is a servant.
Yes.
Mm-hmm. Hallelujah. And this boy came to himself. That is repentance. You know, when he came, his father saw him coming. He didn't go after him, but when he saw him coming back, you know what the father did? He ran to meet him.
Right.
That's God's heart.
Yes.
Hallelujah. Some of us, we would have stood off and said, serve him right. Let's see what's going to happen now. He's coming home, finally found out that he made a terrible mistake, and we're going to make him pay for it now. No. The father ran because you know what? The father did not go after him physically, but his heart went after him. Hallelujah. And he was just glad to see my son, which was lost, is coming home. Hallelujah. He ran, he hugged him. Hallelujah. He says, son, his son began to express to him what he had said in his heart. And he just simply said to his servant, say, go get the best robe. Put it on my boy. Hallelujah. Go kill the fatted calf. We're going to rejoice here. Hallelujah. Church, that's the heart of God. Hallelujah. Jesus said, this is how it is in heaven. When one sinner repent. Even the presumptuously lost, God is concerned.
That's right.
Just to close this off and to finally, this is something we don't talk much about when we tell these stories, but Jesus told it for a reason. Because when they were rejoicing over the brother that had come home and had was lost and now found, his older brother, the Bible says, was in the field. And he came home, he heard the rejoicing. You know what he did? He called a servant and said, "What's happening in there? When you don't know what's happening in the house of God, your father's house, there is something wrong." Praise God. When you hear the saints of God rejoicing and you have to be asking what's going on, something is wrong. Servant said, "Your brother which was dead, which was lost, is now home. Your father is killed. The mighty God, we're rejoicing." You know what the Bible says? The older brother said, "I'm not going in there. You mean my brother which wasted my father's living and wasted everything he had is now home and my father is rejoicing over him? I don't even want to be in there." You know what happened? The Bible says, listen, read what the scripture says. The father came outside and had to come to talk to him. He was in the field. He was working for the father. Amen? He said, "All these years I've served you." As soon as father came, he started complaining. "I've served you all these years. I've been faithful. And you haven't given me one little calf. I know you've killed the fatted calf for my brother who messed up his life." Let me tell you, the father said, "Son, let me tell you this. You have been faithful. And because you have been faithful, everything I have belongs to you. But he said, I want you to understand something. It was right for us to be rejoicing. Because your brother which was lost is now found. He was dead, he is now alive. It is right." Church. This is to me the most serious case of all that which was lost. Because that brother was working in the field, but he had lost a burden for his own brother, which was lost. That may be the worst thing that you could lose, is a burden for the lost. Because that's what God has, and that's what he has given to us. Church, that's why we're in South Sudan. That's why missionaries are going all across this world. That's why this church is right here in Creevecore. Because God loves the lost. And God is determined to reach the lost at any cost. Hallelujah. Praise God. Let's stand.
Lord, in all the earth, great is your power, great is your strength, great are you, Lord, and greatly to be praised.
Great are your ways.
Your power,
great is your strength.